This program originates live with the NBC Television Network.
NBC Sports presents the 1965 World Series. From Metropolitan Stadium in Bloomington, Minnesota, the Los Angeles Dodgers meeting the Minnesota Twins. Brought to you by
the Gillette Safety Razor Company, maker of the slim, adjustable razor. The Gillette Super Stainless, the totally new Gillette Super Stainless Blade. Foamy, the cream of all instant lathers. Right Guard spray deodorant and new Heads Up hairdressing for men.
And by Chrysler Canada Limited and its dealers who sell Imperial, Chrysler, Dodge, Plymouth, Valiant, Dodge and Fargo trucks from Chrysler Canada Limited.
Buddy, this is Ben Scully, along with Ray Scott, welcoming you to Metropolitan Stadium and the first game of this 1965 World Series. To thank you for using their products, Gillette and Chrysler also present for your pleasure the All-Star Baseball Game, NCAA Football, and the 1966 Rose Bowl Game over most of these same NBC stations. Metropolitan Stadium is the scene for the first game of the 1965 World Series. As far as the weather is concerned, a tremendous break. Sunshine and a temperature reported to go as high as 75 degrees. A capacity crowd will be looking on. The crowd here is 45,182, but the largest crowd to ever attend a game was in this year's All-Star Game of 46,700. To set Metropolitan Stadium for you, first, this game is authorized under television rights granted by the Commissioner of Baseball solely for the entertainment of our audience, and any publication, reproduction, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of the Commissioner is prohibited. Any commercial or other use of the program, such as by charging admission for its showing, is similarly prohibited unless authorized in writing by the Commissioner. Let's take a look at Metropolitan Stadium now and check the dimensions. From home plate down the left field line, 344 feet. At the start of the year, it was 330, and they moved it back. The so-called power alley is 365 feet away, falling away to 402 feet, and the deepest part of the park, straightaway center, 430. Then back again to 402, the power alley at 365 in right center, and 330 down the right field line. There is a 12-foot-high wire fence around the ballpark, and in center field, it'll drop to about 10 feet, plus anywhere from 35 to a 40-foot black backdrop to furnish a hitting background for the batters. The starting pitchers during the course of the season would be along the baselines. However, in World Series time, they loosen up in the bullpen. There is Don Drysdale, loosening up for the Dodgers. Drysdale, a 23-game winner last year, has worked in three World Series games, and he has a victory mark of 2-0. Drysdale beat the Chicago White Sox 3-1 in 1959, and he beat the New York Yankees 1-0 last October 5th, 1963. Alongside the visiting bullpen is where the Minnesota Twins pitcher, Jim Grant, will be loosening up. Jimmy, a 21-game winner, making his first World Series appearance. He's the biggest winner in the American League this year, the first Negro pitcher ever to win 20 in a season in the American League. He equaled the Minnesota club victory record this year, a mark originally set by Camilo Pasquale in 1963. Better known as Mudcat, his best previous year, 1961, when he won 15 games for Cleveland. He also led the American League in shutouts with 6. So Jim Grant and Don Drysdale in the first game of the series. Tomorrow will be a battle of left-handers. Jim Cott for the Twins, Sandy Koufax for the Dodgers. Talking about the Dodgers, let's go to their lineup right now. Leading off at shortstop, perhaps the most offensive-minded ball player in the ballpark today, the captain, shortstop Maury Wills. The veteran of the Dodgers, a reactivated coach, Jim Gilliam, at third base. In center field, fleet-footed Willie Davis. In the cleanup spot, Ron Fairley in right field. Out of the minor leagues because of the broken leg suffered by Tommy Davis comes Lou Johnson to be in left field. The rookie in his first year, 22 years old, Jim LaFever, a strong candidate for Rookie of the Year. In his second year in the big show, Wes Parker at first base, hitting seven. Johnny Roseboro will be behind the plate. And the pitcher, Don Drysdale. To illustrate the differences between the two clubs, the overall team batting average of the Twins, 254, to the Dodgers, 245, the Twins hit 150 home runs to the Dodgers, 78. And the Twins scored 774 runs to the Dodgers, 608. And then comes the other glaring difference between the two clubs in the stolen base department. The Twins, who do a good deal of running themselves, stole 90 bases this year. But the Dodgers stole 170, and it is one very strong reason why they are in Minnesota today. The wind that we have, and they tell us it will go anywhere from 18 to 25 miles an hour, is blowing from right to left, so it will favor drives headed for those double-deck stands in left, which are added to Metropolitan Stadium this year. Well, the first game of the 1965 World Series is being brought to you from Metropolitan Stadium in Bloomington, Minnesota.
Here's a test to show you what Tame Cream Rinse can do. This girl rinsed half her hair with Tame. Tame is taken into the hair to condition it. This side without Tame tangles. Rinsed with Tame, tangle-free. Without Tame, dry, fly away. With Tame, manageable and shining. Yes, it's a shame to shampoo without Tame. Tame Cream Rinse.
For extra dry or color-treated hair, use extra conditioning Tame.
And now, another message from our sponsor.
Dippity-doo.
New.
Dippity-doo.
For setting your hair.
Dippity-doo.
Rollers.
Dippity-doo.
Easy, neat.
Dippity-doo.
No slips, no rips.
Dippity-doo. Dippity-doo. Dippity-doo.
Real body holds your set between shampoos.
Dippity-doo.
New.
For you.
They are calling the 1965 World Series the first transplant World Series, in the sense that two franchises formerly of other cities finally get together in the World Series. Oh, certainly the Dodgers have been in them before, along with the Milwaukee Braves and the San Francisco Giants. But the Minnesota Twins are the first transplanted American League club ever to climb the pinnacle, thus setting the stage for this first transplant World Series. And the Minnesota Twins have been a tremendous story, not only leading the American League. And to tell us about that story and the Minnesota Twins, here's the voice of the Minnesota Twins, Ray Scott.
Thank you, Vin Scully, and good afternoon, everybody. Let us look at the starting lineup for the Twins. At shortstop and a leading candidate for most valuable player honors in the American League, Zoilo Versalles. Playing in left field and probably playing in left field when the Dodgers use a right-handed starting pitcher is Sandy Valdespino. The right fielder, and for the second year in a row leading the American League in batting, Tony Oliva. Batting cleanup, and very close to 100% form in his physical condition, is third baseman Harmon Killebrew. Jimmy Hall will be in center field. The first baseman will be Don Mincher. Behind the plate, one of baseball's finest catchers, Earl Batty. At second base, a rookie, Frank Quillacy. And on the mound, Jim Mudcat Grant, with a season's record of 21 wins and 7 losses. Now, the umpires for today's game. At home plate, from the American League, Ed Hurley. At first base, from the National League, Tony Venzin. At second base, the American League's John Flaherty. At third base, Ed Sudol of the National League. And as just about every baseball fan knows, in the World Series, two additional umpires are used. Working the right field line will be the National League's Ed Vargo, and the left field line from the American League, Bob Stewart. as Sam Mealy is at home plate and Captain Mari Wills brings out the Dodger lineup, I think it might be of interest to mention that Sam Mealy, who is facing us right now, is of course thinking about this baseball game. But I know too that his thoughts are on Quincy, Massachusetts, where Mrs. Mealy, Connie, is awaiting almost momentarily the arrival of the fifth child. There are no ground rules of any particular interest, nothing beyond the ordinary that will apply here at Metropolitan Stadium. A fan can reach out and touch a ball here very, very seldom. A home run hit to left field is in almost every instance a home run, and it's there for you to see as such. The meeting at home plate has been concluded. In attendance today, Vice President Hubert Humphrey. He will toss out the first ball of this 1965 World Series. Tomorrow, by the way, the first ball will be thrown out by the governor of the state of Minnesota, Karl Rovog. So the vice president with Mrs. Humphrey. Vice President Humphrey, of course, no stranger in these parts. He is, among other accomplishments, a former mayor of the city of Minneapolis. The national anthem will be played by the Ralph Mendenhall Band. Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem. Giving the starting lineup for the Minnesota Twins, I should have mentioned that in addition to Frank Quillacy, left fielder Sandy Valdespino is also a rookie, although Sandy toiled long in the minor leagues before getting his major league opportunity. The vice president is poised. I must admit, I know little of his pitching prowess. I know he is a dyed-in-the-wool baseball fan. Governor Rovog is just behind the vice president, just over his left shoulder. I don't know whether he's picking out a favorite player or not. He was eyeing the field pretty well, deciding which way he was going to throw the ball. The announcement is being made by the public address announcer, Bob Casey. The announcement concerning the ceremonial throwing out of the first ball, and the crowd rises. Earl Batty is the recipient. The day before the Twins clinched the American League pennant, the vice president was with the Twins in the clubhouse. So we're just a moment away as we look at the Twins defensively. At first base is Don Mincher. At second base, Frank Quillacy, and alongside him, the shortstop, Zoilo Versailles. Harmon Killebrew is at third base. In left field, Sandy Valdespino. Fleet Jimmy Hall in center. Tony Oliva is the right fielder. Earl Batty is the Twins catcher. And on the mound, Jim Mudcat Grant. The Dodger coaches at first base is Danny Ozark. And at third base is Preston Gomez. We pause briefly for station identification. Ed Hurley is conferring along with manager Sam Mealy as Maury Wills awaits his turn at bat. He's already been announced as the leadoff batter, but manager Walter Alston of the Dodgers and manager Sam Mealy of the Twins and Ed Hurley, the home plate umpire, have been conferring with the commissioner of baseball, Mr. Ford Frick. And of course, we can only guess as to the subject of their conversation. There's the commissioner. Jim Grant, the Twins pitcher, in his greatest season in the big leagues, a 21-game winner. He worked 270 and a third innings. His earned run average was 3.30. And to use an oft-used baseball phrase, he won the big games for the Twins. His record against first division opponents was outstanding. The Twins defensively against Wills have Hall shallow in center. Killebrew in on the grass at third. The shortstop, Versailles, however, three quarters of the way back. And here is the first pitch of the 65 series, and it's a called strike one. I asked Jim Grant just what it's like in facing this fellow Wills just before the game.
My thought on Maury Wills is that I know that he's the best base stealer in baseball, but I can't elect let his running affect my thinking on the hitter. So I'll just forget him, keep him close, and I know if I keep him close, Earl Batty can throw him out.
Wills trying to bunt his way on. Foul and a count of strike two. Ben Scully, could I ask you, were there any of the National League clubs that used an unusual sort of a defense against Wills to protect the bunt?
Ray, when Wills is batting left-handed in the National League against a fellow who throws pretty hard, the left fielder almost sits on the foul line.
A two-strike count on Wills during the season, a .286 batting average. Foul into the Dodger dugout. The wind blowing strong, right to left. Strike three. Although Jim Grant is basically a fastball pitcher, he added to his pitching repertoire this year what has come to be known not so much as a hard curve, but the Johnny Sane curve, because the Twins pitching coach, Sane, was mainly responsible in teaching the pitch to Grant. It has helped him a lot. Here is Junior Gilliam. Ball one inside. Junior, player, coach for the Dodgers, a .280 batting average. Batting here in the first inning with one out and none on, and the game just underway. Strike, one and one. Grant has excellent control. A foul tip, ball one, strike two. Grant, in working 270 and a third innings, walked only 61 while striking out 142. A count of ball one and strike two to Junior Gilliam. Right fielder Tony Oliva. Two away. As Willie Davis comes to the plate, I'm wondering if there has ever been a major league infield where every man was a switch hitter. Vin Scully shakes his head no. Certainly, I know no other major league infield as the Dodgers have now, and certainly this means an awful lot to the success of a team because you can stabilize that infield. Willie Davis, the center fielder. Regular season batting average, .238. Ball one. The Twins shade the outfield a bit to right for Davis. Tony Oliva.
Not long ago, the stainless steel blade was one of the best razor blades you could buy. Today, you might as well forget it. It and every other ordinary stainless steel blade. Because of this, the Gillette Super Stainless. The totally new Gillette Super Stainless blade. The new Gillette Super Stainless is better than any other blade you've ever used because of two things. A new high chrome stainless steel that takes and holds an incredibly sharp edge and a smooth new coating, more effective than anything else discovered. The result? Miracle edges and a cleaner, closer, more comfortable shave. So don't buy just another stainless steel blade. Make it super stainless. Gillette Super Stainless with the miracle edges. Your shave will last longer. So will the blade.
Defensively, at first base, Wes Parker. At second base, Jim LeFevre. Mari Wills is the shortstop. And Junior Gilliam is at third. In the outfield and left, Lou Johnson. The center fielder is Willie Davis. The right fielder is Ron Fairley. The catcher is John Roseborough. And on the mound, 23-game winner Don Drysdale. The twin coaches at first, Jim Lemon. And at third, Billy Martin. Leading off for the Twins, the shortstop, Zoilo Versailles. .273 regular season batting average, led the American League in total bases. Versailles didn't get the big breaking ball. Dodger outfield almost straight away. Center fielder Willie Davis, perhaps two steps toward left. Fastball outside, 1-1. Wins bat in the first inning, there is no score. Don Drysdale. Hard to put into words his value to the Dodgers. Curve low, ball two, strike one. Drysdale's earned run average after 308 regular season innings, a sparkling 2.78. Outside fastball, 2-2. Call back out of play. One concession has been made to the World Series as far as seating is concerned. Some additional field boxes were added along the left field and right field lines. Gilliam has retreated at third with a 2-2 count to Versailles. Strikeout. So one away in the Twins' first inning. And here is the left fielder, Sandy Valdespino. Sandy, a valuable member of the Twins this season as manager Sam Mealy, went to platooning at some positions. And Sandy has played mainly in left, although at times was used in right. Third baseman in tight, and Parker, the first baseman, is not too deep. Foul into the seats for strike one. And a broken bat. The month of September in the Twin Cities is a month that longtime residents would just as soon forget as far as the weather is concerned. But this, the first week of October, is what the longtime residenters will tell you is a typical October in this area. You just couldn't ask for a finer day. A strike to Valdespino. First inning, no score. Twins batting with one out and none on. Foul back. Two strike count. The Twins would like to think that their ability to run is not measured alone by the stolen base, but rather by the taking of the extra base. Fouled away. Valdespino is fleet of foot. Sandy asks the plate umpire Ed Hurley examine the baseball. Big hop for the second baseman Lefevre and two down.
We asked Don Drysdale about his philosophy of pitching before the game today, and here's his idea.
My best pitches are fastball, curveball, and change, and sometimes I'll change off of my curveball. Primarily in this series, well, I'm going to try and keep the ball down. I am a low ball pitcher, and from what we've heard, most of the Minnesota players are high ball hitters, so I've got to go just the opposite way and go to my strength.
Tony Oliva is the Twins' batter. He's the American League batting champion for the second year in a row. Last year won it as a rookie, and that's the first time a rookie ever won it. Foul back. Oliva, .321 regular season batting average. Last season, he won the title hitting .323. Most American League pitchers would tell you that Oliva has no known weakness. Although a pretty definite pattern has developed, they believe that they have their best luck with him pitching him high and tight. A ball high, one and one. Oliva has been playing for quite a while with a bone chip in the middle finger of the right hand, and for a time it caused him to throw a bat many, many times, more than would usually be the case. Foul back, one and two. The last of the first inning and no score from Metropolitan Stadium in Bloomington, Minnesota, the first game of the 1965 World Series. Fouled away. Dodgers play Oliva to hit to all fields. No shifting one way or the other. Wills, 1-2-3 inning for Drysdale. And so at the end of the first inning, the score is the Dodgers nothing and the Twins nothing. This 1965 World Series game is being brought to you live and in color. Exclusively on NBC. Well, the pitcher certainly dominated the first inning. We haven't had a base runner yet as the Dodgers come up in the second. It will be the right fielder, Ron Fairley, the left fielder, Lou Johnson, and the second baseman, Jim LeFevre. Fairley led the Dodgers in runs batted in with 70 while compiling a .274 batting average. Grant coming in high. The Twins play Fairley slightly to the right. Ball two. Foul back. Ball two and strike one. I believe the wind may be dying down just a bit. 3-1. Ron has had his look down at third base coach Preston Gomez. This one will be out of play along the left field line and a full count. To my knowledge, Vin, no one was clever enough to get into the ballpark and stay all night so that although minus a ticket, they'd still see the series.
If they did, they're not going to talk about it.
Harmon Killebrew near the stands. But it's out of play. I checked with some of the men who did the searching, and they said that as far as they knew, no culprits were found in the stands. I understand at the All-Star game, which was played here in this same ballpark in Metropolitan Stadium, one man tried to get in wearing an expensive suit but carrying 100 pounds of ice and said he was the ice man. Full count to Ron Fairley. Deep. A home run, and the Dodgers take the lead by 1-0 as Ron Fairley lines a 3-2 fastball over the right field fence. So the Dodgers break through by using the long ball. Fairley homered 9 times in the regular season. Here now is the left fielder, Lou Johnson. .259 regular season batting average. Foul back on the bunt attempt for strike one. Jim Grant gave up more home runs than any other Twin pitcher. 34. 1-1. Rather strike two. And I was checking the Dodgers, and Drysdale led the Dodger staff in giving up homers, which I guess in effect is a tribute to their great control. 2-strike count on Lou Johnson. Fairley's homer is listed as traveling about 370 feet. High fastball, ball one, strike two. First World Series homer for Ron Fairley. Strikeout for Grant, his second.
Number five. Back to England. Jeff McFeeler.
The day the Twins clinched the pennant, rather the day before they clinched the pennant, Grant came up with one of his finest efforts of the season, a one-hit performance over the Senators. The batter is Jim LeFevre, taking ball one. And I guess, Vin, if you could point your finger at any one Dodger who was really outstanding in the stretch run, it would be this young man right here. Sandy Valdespino in left, waiting the fly ball. Two down. The Dodgers with a 1-0 lead on Ron Fairley's line drive homer over the fence and right. Here's the right. Here is the first baseman, Wes Parker. Strike one. Outside, one and one. The sun first broke through about, I'd say 2 hours before the start of today's game. Been hiding every once in a while, but right now it's in full sunshine. Low, ball two, two and one.
Ron Fairley's last home run this season came on August 23rd.
Near the left field corner. Foul. So the count goes to two and two on Parker. The addition of the permanent stands beyond the left field fence, the double-deck stands, has, in the opinion of Twins players, cut down considerably on the number of home runs that have been hit to left field and will be hit. Full count as the fastball is inside.
Stop. Using a stainless steel blade, getting a good shave, the best possible shave. You sure? When you bought it, the stainless steel blade was one of the best in the world. Today, you might as well forget it. It and every other ordinary stainless steel blade. Thanks to this, the Gillette Super Stainless, the totally new Gillette Super Stainless blade. What makes it so much better than ordinary stainless steel blades? A new high chrome stainless steel that takes and holds an incredibly sharp edge. And a smooth new coating more effective than anything else discovered. The result? Miracle edges and a cleaner, closer, more comfortable shave. So don't buy just another stainless steel blade. Make it super stainless. Gillette Super Stainless with the miracle edges. Your shave will last longer. So will the blade.
I asked Harmon Killebrew a short while ago his thoughts concerning Dodger pitcher Don Drysdale.
Well, we know Don's got a real good fastball that moves in on you and also moves away at times and also has a fine slider. I think his motion makes him most deceptive, and he's a real tough pitcher to face.
Killebrew wound up the season with 25 home runs and 75 runs batted in at a batting average of .269. Harmon missed almost 7 weeks because of an elbow dislocation. Breaking ball a bit high, ball one. Drysdale retired the Twins 1-2-3 in the first inning on a strikeout and two ground balls. Dodger outfield is shaded to the left. Breaking ball low, ball two. Killebrew will be followed by Jimmy Hall and Don Mincher. Strike. Two, strike two. Third baseman Junior Gilliam is pretty close to the line for Killebrew. Strikeout number two for Drysdale. With one away in the second inning, center fielder Jimmy Hall.
Jimmy.
It is manager Sam Mealy's intention to platoon in center field with Hall and the right-handed batting Joe Nosek, in left field with Sandy Valdespino starting today against Drysdale, and when the Dodgers use a left-hander, he will go to Bob Allison. Barring a change in the manager's thinking or something that would happen in the course of World Series play, those will be the only two spots where they'll platoon. Curve over to Hall. Strike one. Hall knocked in 86 runs, homered 20 times, and had a .285 batting average. He is very fast. Strike two. Dodgers had their head of scouting, Al Campanis, following the Twins for quite a while, and it was his book that is guiding the Dodgers. Another strikeout for Drysdale. So three strikeouts now for the big right-hander, and with two out and none on in the second, and the Dodgers leading 1-0, here is Don Mincher. Twins first baseman hit .252 in the regular season. He is always a threat to hit the long ball. 22 homers, 65 runs batted in. Strike. Drysdale not giving him very much speed. Hit high, 1-1. While taking batting practice today, Don came out of the cage and he said, well, just another game. And then he started shaking his hands and dropped his bat. He said, Scotty, this has just got to be the biggest day in a ball player's life. Deep to right. High ball game. Replay, the home run. Deep to right. And the right fielder, Ron Fairley, knew it about the moment the ball left the bat. Drysdale's first pitch to catcher Earl Batty is fouled away for strike one. Batty, a .298 regular season batting average, six home runs, 60 runs batted in. Left fielder, Johnson. The Twins are out. And so at the end of the second inning, the score is the Dodgers 1 and the Twins 1.
See this man? He's using a stainless steel blade. Has since they were introduced. He thinks they're great. Yet, he'll never buy another one. Nope. He'll never buy another ordinary stainless steel blade because the Gillette Super Stainless is here. The totally new Gillette Super Stainless blade, made of a new high chrome stainless steel that takes and holds an incredibly sharp edge with a smooth new coating more effective than anything else discovered. The result? Miracle edges and a cleaner, closer, more comfortable shave. So don't buy just another stainless steel blade. Make it super stainless. Gillette Super Stainless with the miracle edges. Your shave will last longer. So will the blade.
We would remind you that we'd like to have you with us again tomorrow, 2:45 Eastern Daylight Time, for the second game of this 1965 World Series, live and in color, exclusively on NBC. For the Dodgers in the third, with the score tied at 1-1, the catcher, John Roseborough, the pitcher, Don Drysdale, and the shortstop, Maury Wills. Roseborough, 238 regular season average. Fastball inside for ball one. And when the pitcher comes up for the Dodgers, and his name is Drysdale, he's a hitter. Strike, one and one. Ron Fairley and Don Mincher with matching home runs and the score tied at 1-1. Strike two. Twin outfield just a bit to the right. Killebrew by the Dodger dugout. There is apparently still enough of a wind blowing that if the ball gets up near the top of the stands, it'll cause some trouble. I'll give you an indication as to the way the wind is blowing right now. It was listed as possibly gusting up as high as 25 miles an hour. Drysdale, 300 batting average, 19 runs batted in, 39 hits, including seven homers. A high curve, ball one. Foul out of play, one and one. Hit on the ground against Grant, giving some indication that he has been using the fastball to great advantage. And with two away, up for the second time in the game is Maury Wills. Grant got him on a called third strike in the first inning. Now the Twins are going to play the right side of the infield about halfway as Wills comes to the plate for the second time in the game. Versailles and Killebrew and Valdespino, and it's Versailles. Grant works a 1-2-3 inning at the end of 2 1/2 innings to score. The Dodgers won and the Twins won.
You wouldn't think of buying a dress too small or a sandwich too big. You wouldn't have a mop too short or eyelashes too long. You insist your glasses fit right. Your cake bakes light. But what about your pen? Size counts there, too, and just as much. Size makes writing easy or hard, cramped or comfortable. That's why Papermate designed the three different sized, shaped, and weighted pens in the Papermate Profile Trio. That one's the slim, light, responsive, smart. That's the husky, real heft and weight. Substantial. And the regular, average size and weight, the one most people like. Three pens, three sizes, shapes, and weights. The Papermate Profile Trio. Pick the one that's right for you.
In the last of the third inning, with the score tied at 1-1 in this first game of the 1965 World Series, the Twins will send up rookie second baseman Frank Quillacy, the pitcher Jim Grant, and the shortstop, Zoilo Versailles. Quillacy, with the Twins only the latter portion of the season after being recalled from Denver, knocked in just seven runs. But he knocked in the winning and insurance runs in the game that saw the Twins clinch a tie for the pennant. And he scored the winning run in a 2-1 victory in the pennant clinching game after doubling. Foul back, strike one. Fairley homered in the Dodger second, and Don Mincher homered in the last of the same inning, and so it's a 1-1 game. Foul away on the right side, strike two. Dodgers figure that Quillacy will not pull Drysdale and have the center fielder well over toward right. Curve low, ball one, strike two. Drysdale has struck out three. Grant has struck out three. Satisfied with a double.
Right, nine.
The second hit off Drysdale. And the Twins pitcher, Jim Grant, comes to the plate. Now, Grant, despite a 155 batting average, has power, included in his 15 hits, three doubles, two triples. He knocked in eight runs. And catcher John Roseboro wants to huddle with Drysdale and Billy Martin. Certainly no stranger to World Series activity. The Twins' third base coach has had a word with Jim Grant. The Dodgers already are setting up the infield in anticipation of a bunt. Fielding play.
What made it good for Don to try was the fact that LeFevre was there. If he was in motion to handle the throw, then he would have been in trouble.
It is ruled a sacrifice, moving the runner Quillacy to third. An error is charged to Jimmy LeFevre, who took the throw. And Drysdale, of course, gets an assist. Have runners at first and third with no outs. And the batter is Versailles, a strikeout victim in the first inning. Batting almost exclusively in the leadoff spot this season, he knocked in 77 twin runs. The infield is at about three-quarter depth at short and at second. Strike one. Score is tied 1-1. On third, Quillacy. On first, Grant. Outfield shaded a little bit to the left. Outside, 1-1. There is still quite a divot, and you might notice it there and out in front of the plate, taken by Drysdale as he tried to make the play on the sacrifice bunt by Jim Grant. Regular season. The Twins take a 4-1 lead. And here is Valdespino, bounced out first time up. Deep to right, off the fence. Valdespino digging for second, a double. Manager Walter Alston heads to the mound. Hurried warm-up activity by Howie Reed in the Dodger bullpen. You know, Ben, try as I might, I have never yet, from the vantage point of a broadcast booth, been ever to be able to say with anything of approaching authority, well, now, that was a slider or that was a curve, and it appeared to me that the pitch hit by Versailles definitely was up.
Ray, the one thing about Drysdale, after watching him all these years, although he has not walked a batter, his control right now is very bad. He is doing exactly the opposite of what he wanted to do.
There's Howie Reed in the Dodger bullpen. No outs. Three runs in. The Twins are leading 4-1. Valdespino is on second. And the batter is Tony Oliva, grounded out short to first in the first inning. As a sudden barrage has Drysdale in trouble. Tight at third is Gilliam. Outfield straight away. Foul, strike one. And the ball almost thrown into center field. A great retrieve by Mari Wills. Now, strike two. Drysdale's last two regular season efforts resulted in shutouts. But the Twins have used the long ball plus one Dodger error to assume a 4-1 lead and still have a runner at second with no outs here in the third. Time called by the plate umpire, Ed Hurley. Foul back. When Tony Oliva bats, Jim Lemon is a very deep first base coach because of Tony's unfortunate habit of throwing the bat. Jim has had to duck on more than one occasion. A ball and two strikes. Third baseman Gilliam out at first, and Valdespino holds at second. One down.
Number three, Monticello.
His strikeout victim in the second inning. One of three Twin batsmen struck out by Drysdale. The Dodger outfield will go deep and well around to the left. Corner at the letters. were getting mainly a diet of breaking pitches. In addition to Howie Reed, the right-hander, the lefty is Jim Brewer in the Dodger bullpen beyond the right center field fence. 4-1 is the score. The Twins are leading. One out. Valdespino is on second base. This is the last of the third. Valdespino. With the left-handed batter up, Oliva, Wills took the throw. This time it's Jimmy LeFevre. Ball two, strike one, the count to Killebrew. Foul back, 2-2. Twins, of course, have seen Drysdale in spring training games. Killebrew, among others, rates Drysdale's fastball as a truly great fastball when it's doing what Drysdale wants it to do. Base hit. Valdespino is held at third. Runners first and third. One away. Valdespino on third. Killebrew on first. The batter is Jimmy Hall, a strikeout victim in the second inning. Five hits off Drysdale in two and a third inning. Over the right ear. He was hit by a pitch here several years ago. Low ball two. Valdespino is the runner on third. Killebrew is the runner on first. Hall is played to pull by the Dodger outfield. Inside with his fastball, ball three. On deck is Don Mincher. His home run in the second inning tied the game at 1-1. So it's 3-1. Roseboro back at the stands, but he'll have no play. And a full count. Frank Quillacy led off the third inning for the Twins with a ground double between Gilliam and the third base bag. Grant sacrificed, and when Drysdale's throw to first was juggled by Jim LeFevre, an error resulted in the Twins had runners at first and third with no outs. Versailles homered to make it 4-1. Valdespino double. Oliva grounded out with the runner holding at second, and then Killebrew's base hit to left moved Valdespino to third, and it's 3-2 to Hall. Safe at first. Valdespino, a conservative lead at third. two down. Here's Mencher.
Number five, John Mencher.
First baseman Wes Parker will apparently not hold with Killebrew in this situation. Foul, strike one. One of the reasons these two teams are in the World Series is because they have made great use of such fundamental tactics is the hit and run and so forth, and yet here we have five runs scored and all of them on the long ball, the home run. High, one and one. Drysdale has thrown many pitches here in the third inning. Valdespino, the Twins runner at third. Killebrew leading at first. Ball two, two and one. Brewer is no longer throwing in the Dodger bullpen, but Howie Reed, the right-hander, is still doing some tossing. Three and one. Mencher is the eighth Twin to bat here in the third. Dodgers will play Batty as an opposite field hitter. Curve low, ball one. Pickoff attempt takes perfect timing. Willie Davis, the Dodger center fielder, was moving toward the bag in the event of an off-target throw. Strike, one and one. Valdespino, who had doubled with no outs, is on second. Killebrew on second base. He's single. Mencher walked as the runner at first. Foul back, one and two. Dodger batters due up in the fourth inning, the two, three, and four men in the order. Drysdale already has two World Series victories. He's never lost a decision in the series. Ball Angels League single just beyond the outstretched hands of second baseman Jim Lefebvre was too shallow for Fairley, the right fielder. The Twins have batted around, and up for the second time is Frank Willison. His double started off the inning. And the Twins lead by 6-1. Foul out of play, strike one. Mincher went to third on the hit. Batty is on first. Now that's the log on the new pitcher. Meanwhile, Drysdale will depart, having worked just 2 2/3 innings. Off Drysdale, 7 hits. He struck out 4. And while the record will show that the big Dodger right-hander walked only one man, the statistical record will not show that he was behind many hitters. And so the Twins get to the Dodger starter here in the first game of the series and lead 7-1, and still have runners at first and second with 2 out. The Twins pitcher, Jim Grant, will be the first batter to face Reed. Drysdale leaves the mound. The Twins have had the label of these last few years of being a power team, and did indeed last year in 1964 hit 221 home runs, which was the second highest total for a team in Major League history. The Twins this year have not come up with the big inning on many occasions. They have, as mentioned earlier, had to scratch and scrounge for runs, while not to the extent that the Dodgers have had. They still have used the hit and run and so forth. But today it's been in the main the long ball. We watch Howie Reed warming up from our camera at ground level directly behind home plate here at Metropolitan Stadium. This Saturday, NBC will telecast a major college football battle when Duke meets Pitt in the NCAA Game of the Week, live and in color, at 12:30 Eastern Daylight Time, 11:30 Central Time, exclusively on NBC. Remember that before every college football game is the Bud Wilkinson NCAA Preview Show. Jim Grant comes to the plate. Was up earlier in this third inning, was called upon to sacrifice a runner to third, and wound up a base runner himself. A tapper to the right side. LeFever to first. The Twins are out and score six runs. And so at the end of the third inning, the score is the Twins 7 and the Dodgers 1. We pause now for station identification.
This is the CBC Television Network.
Commissioner Ford Frick is here today, of course, in this, his final World Series, in his official capacity as the Commissioner of Baseball. He is seated near the Vice President of the United States, Hubert Humphrey, who tossed out the first ball today. Their boxes are located just to the home plate side of the Twins' dugout on the first base side.
Number 19.
The Twins leading 7-1. And here in the Dodger fourth inning, it will be the third baseman, Junior Gilliam, the center fielder, Willie Davis, and the right fielder, Ron Fairley. Grant has allowed one hit, the second inning homer by Ron Fairley. Gilliam flied out to right in the first inning. Strike one. Junior Gilliam, who was ready when needed by the Dodgers this year. Fastball in close, ball two, strike one. The Twins are playing with Valdespino in left, Hall in center, and Oliva in right, and an infield of Killebrew, Versailles, Quillacy, and Mincher. Into left center field, and a base hit. Jimmy Hall returns the ball to the infield, hit number two off Grant.
Number three, Willie Davis.
Here's Willie Davis. Sent Oliva to the fence in right center, where the Twins' right fielder made a leaping grab of his liner in the first inning. Grant has issued no walks. He has struck out three. One. Breaking ball over, 1-1. Foul back off the curve. Ball one, strike two. Strike out for Grant. A little bit off his fastball that time. One out and one on in the Dodger fourth inning, and here is Ron Fairley. Hit a 3-2 pitch over the right field fence in the second inning for his first World Series homer. In the regular season, Fairley homered 9 times. Right. Barely asks that the ball be examined. Twins first baseman Mincher not holding with the runner, with the Twins leading 7-1. Ball one, 1-1. Standing room tickets were put on sale this morning. To the best of my knowledge, they were all disposed of in a short while. Outside, ball two, 2-1. Fairley led the Dodgers in runs batted in with 70. Three and one. Oliva in right field. Two down.
Number 41, Lou Johnson.
The Dodger left fielder, Lou Johnson, is the batter. Struck out in the second. You know, Vin, I think of anybody, regardless of their line of work, thinks they're not getting anywhere after many years of labor, could look to Lou Johnson for encouragement.
To further illustrate the point, in 13 years, this is his 18th club.
Ball one to Lou Johnson. Runner on first is Gilliam. Two out, Dodger fourth inning. The Twins are leading 7-1. Ball two. Strike one. Soft liner to Versailles, and the Dodgers are out, leaving one man on. So at the end of three and a half innings, the score is the Twins 7 and the Dodgers 1.
Not long ago, the stainless steel blade was one of the best razor blades you could buy. Today, you might as well forget it. It and every other ordinary stainless steel blade. Because of this, the Gillette Super Stainless. The totally new Gillette Super Stainless blade. The new Gillette Super Stainless is better than any other blade you've ever used because of two things. A new high chrome stainless steel that takes and holds an incredibly sharp edge, and a smooth new coating, more effective than anything else discovered. The result? Miracle edges and a cleaner, closer, more comfortable shave. So don't buy just another stainless steel blade. Make it Super Stainless. Gillette Super Stainless with the miracle edges. Your shave will last longer. So will the blade.
In the last of the fourth, the Twins will send up the top of the order as American League President Joe Cronin looks on. Joe, not only a member of baseball's Hall of Fame, former great player, manager, baseball executive. Zoilo Versailles, the Twins shortstop, with a strikeout and a three-run homer to his credit. He'll be followed by Valdespino and Oliva. Howie Reed on the mound. Foul, the bunt attempt, strike one. Third base side foul, strike two. Strike three call. First strikeout for Reed. And with one away, the batter will be Valdespino.
Number 28, Sandy Valdespino.
Drysdale struck out 4 in working 2 2/3 innings. One down in the fourth, and Valdespino rounded out second to first in the first inning and doubled to right in the middle of the Twins' 6-run rally in the third inning. Ball one. Just about the same kind of weather tomorrow, which means just about perfect. Shallow right field. Center fielder, Willie Davis. Two away.
Number six.
Here's Tony Oliva. In facing Drysdale, Oliva grounded out twice by way of the shortstop in the first and the third baseman in the third. The Twins have managed 7 hits. Grant has limited the Dodgers to 2, including Ron Fairley's home run in the second inning. For the Twins, there have been homers by Mincher with none on in the second, and Versailles with 2 on in the third. Foul. A comedy of errors becomes a comedy of terrors on I Spy at 10, 9 Central Time, following Bob Hope Presents. Join secret agents Robert Culp and Bill Cosby on the prowl tonight. That's in color on NBC. A strike to Tony Oliva. Ball one. Two out and none on. This is the last of the fourth. Center fielder Willie Davis. 1-2-3 inning worked by Howie Reed. So at the end of the fourth inning, the score is the Twins 7 and the Dodgers 1.
To be a rookie in your first World Series, Jim LaFever said this.
After going through the National League pennant and the way it finished, about 4 or 5 teams at the last month had a chance for it, I'd say that so far the pennant race has been a little bit more nerve-wracking than the start of the World Series. I can't say for sure right now about how I'm going to feel as the games go, but for the first game, I'm not much excited. I mean, not as much excited as I was about the pennant.
The young Dodgers second baseman takes a fastball high for ball one. LaFever sent a fly ball to left in the second. Grant has allowed 2 hits. Fairley's homer in the second, Gilliam's single leading off the fourth. Strike, 1-1. Foul away on the left side. Ball one, strike two. It is expected that today's attendance figure will be somewhere around 51,000. Just inside of the letters, 2-2. When the White Sox had pulled within 5 games of the Twins the first week of September, it was Grant who beat the White Sox at Chicago 3-2 in a very big game. Full count here to Jim LaFever.
6 runs scored by the Twins in the third inning, for the most runs scored in 1 inning against Los Angeles this year. During the season, 5 runs were scored against the Dodgers in 1 inning on 4 occasions.
Ground ball to the second baseman, Quillacy. to Mincher. One away. The announcement has been made here in the press area, which today is an enlarged press area because of the series, that the 6 runs scored in the third inning by the Twins represented the biggest inning against the Dodgers this season. In the regular season, 5 runs were scored against the Dodgers on 4 occasions. Wes Parker sending a fly ball to left. Sandy Valdespino, the left fielder there. 2 down. With 2 away in the Dodger fifth inning, the runner will be the catcher,
John Roseborough.
Fouled out to third baseman Harmon Killebrew in the third inning. It is expected that tomorrow's second game will see a battle of left-handers. Sandy Koufax and Jim Cott. Strike one. Fastball high, 1-1. The American League umpire, as I'm sure you've noticed, stands directly behind the catcher. Tomorrow, you'll see a National League umpire working the plate, and his position's a little bit different. Grant's curveball is low. Ball 2, strike 1. Two out, none on. Dodger fifth inning, Twins leading 7-1. Ball 3. Grant has 4 strikeouts to his credit. Base hit to right. Hit number 3. And Willie Crawford will bat for Howie Reed. So there'll be a new Dodger pitcher in the third of the day when the Twins bat in the fifth inning.
Batting for the pitcher, Howie Reed. Number 43, Willie Crawford.
Crawford in the regular season up just 27 times and had 4 hits. And the new Dodger pitcher will be left-hander Jim Brewer. Strike. Grant's fastball generally tails away from the left-handed batter. 1-1. From the middle innings on, left field becomes somewhat of a problem when the sun is shining here at Metropolitan Stadium. Just below the knees, ball 2, strike 2. On strikes in the first inning and popped up to the shortstop in the third. 4 hits off Jim Grant and Earl Batty and Harmon Killebrew consulting with the Twins pitcher. Killebrew is the accepted Twins leader. and always in a very quiet sort of a way. Foul will be out of play for strike one. Dodger runners first and second with two out. One and one. The Dodger runners at second. Roseboro, Willie Crawford on first. Ball two. Jim Grant in two out, two on trouble. Long way to go, and Jimmy Hall there. And Grant is out of the inning as the Dodgers lead 2 men off. The end of 4.5 innings, the score is 2-7. The second half of today's game is brought to you by Chrysler Corporation.
Your Chrysler Canada dealer presents Hit Parade for 66, a lineup of cars that are bound to lead the parade. Exciting Chrysler. Move up. Enjoy the Chrysler way of life. Big Dodge. Dodge gives you more than ever before. More size, more comfort, more pride. It's a lot more car for your money. Swinging Coronet by Dodge. Coronet's a new idea from Dodge. Plymouth, twice the Tiger for 66. There's the hot new Belvedere, a smart new sizzler from Plymouth. Then there's the big new Plymouth Fury. Nothing goes like Fury. Spirited Valiant. Nobody beats Valiant for value. See them all now at your Chrysler Canada dealers during Hit Parade 66.
As we move into the last half of the fifth inning, it is my pleasure to bring in now the broadcaster of the Los Angeles Dodgers to carry you along the rest of the way, Vin Scully. Vin?
Thank you, Ray, and hi, everybody. Left-hander Jim Brewer comes out of the Dodger bullpen, and it has certainly been a while for Brewer to see any action. In going back through the scorebook of the year, we have gone back into the season over 3 weeks and have not come up with his name. Brewer took a long time to come around to really be a major league pitcher. The last time he worked was September the 4th, so it's been a month. And the pitch that made him a major leaguer is now the pitch causing all the trouble, the screwball. When Brewer came up with the screwball, the Dodgers felt they had themselves quite a find. But in pitching the screwball, twice, Brewer has hurt his elbow and each time sidelined for a considerable time. He'll be pitching to Harmon Killebrew, Jimmy Hall, and Don Minshew. 7 runs, 7 hits, and no errors for the Twins. They've left 2. A run on 4 hits and an error for the Dodgers. They've left 3. Harmon Killebrew struck out and singled. 1-for-2. Breaking ball fouled away. The 1965 Dodger Ball Club has been compared somewhat to the 1959 Dodger Ball Club that was kind of a scrambler. And if so, they are carrying the comparison out to the umpteenth degree, because the 1959 Ball Club lost the opening game to the Chicago White Sox 11-0. 1-1 to Killebrew. Ball two. The outfield very deep and around the left on Killebrew. Breaking ball, 2-2. For the Dodgers, Don Drysdale, Howie Reed, and now Jim Brewer. Screwball low, ball three, as the players call it, the Scroogey. Fastball. On the corner and down he goes. The Jim set him up, struck him out with the fastball. Well, friends, this 1965 World Series game is being brought to you live and in color, exclusively on NBC.
Jimmy Hall.
Round of applause for Jimmy Hall, who made the fine running catch on the drive by Maury Wills in the fifth inning. Jimmy struck out twice against Drysdale. Right. The one thing for Drysdale, you look up the Cole stats and you say he walked one, but he was way off in his control. Grant, on the other hand, appears to be following his game plan to perfection. 1-1. Ball two, 2-1. Breaking ball hit up along first base, kicks foul. The Hall will come back and try it again, 2-2. For the Dodgers to look at the scoreboard and be down by six has to be discouraging. Their whole attack is based on the fact they stay close. You take away the steal and the hit and run when you are as far back as they are. However, one of the biggest games they won in the closing weeks of the year, they trailed 6-1 to the Braves. Won at 7-6. 2-2 to Jimmy Hall. Fastball hit to the hole, off the glove of Lefevre, and on out on the grass.
Base hit.
It'll be a base hit for Jimmy Hall.
Base hit.
Off Lefevre's glove, and here is Don
Number
Mincher.
Five, Don Mincher.
Mincher got the Twins even with his home run in the second inning, and then walked in the third. Eight hits for Minnesota. Ball one. High pop fly. Wills looks at Lefevre, and Lefevre will handle it. And lets it drop on purpose to get Hall off the bases. So it goes a force play 4-6 to remove Jimmy Hall. And Mincher aboard at first. And with two out, Earl Batty coming out.
Number 10, Earl Batty.
Force play 4-6. Fielder's choice 4-6.
So the Dodgers would much rather have Mincher aboard than Hall. And here's Batty, who is more or less a first ball hitter. Earl has flied to left and single to right. Takes a strike. Seven to one in favor of Minnesota. We're in the bottom of the fifth inning, two out. Don Mincher at first base. Screwball. 0-2. Frank Quillacy on deck. 0-2 to Earl Batty. In the dirt to the backstop, Minshew to second base on the wild pitch. Minnesota 7, Dodgers 1, bottom of the fifth, 2 out, 1-2 to Batty with Don Mincher at second base. The only Dodger on, a home run by Ron Fairley. The Twins have had home runs by Don Mincher and Zolo Versailles. One and two. Curve hit off the fists, a ground ball to Lefevre. Throws him out. No runs ahead, a man left, and at the end of five innings of play, Minnesota 7 and the Dodgers 1.
Take a good, long, hard look at Dodge for 66. Dodge is big. Looks, in size, in room, in comfort, in everything. Dodge is luxurious, outside and inside. Dodge is proud. Dodge looks like a Dodge. Take a good look at Dodge. It's the most car in the popular price field.
Get more, get a lot more. Get a lot more cars for your money. Get Dodge for 66.
Yes, Dodge is a lot more car for your money.
Get Dodge for 66.
League President Warren Giles of the National League is watching his 14th World Series as president of the league and is serving his 29th year as a National League executive. He took over as president in 1951 after serving in the front office of the Cincinnati Reds for 15 years.
Here are the financial figures on today's first game. The paid attendance...
Jim Gilliam, Willie Davis, and Ron Fairley in that order.
797. 47,797, which is a New Stadium record.
Breaking ball just missed, 1-1. Gilliam has flied to right and singled to center, 1-2. The veteran on the Dodgers.
After taxes,
he was the rookie of the year in 1953. Out of the way, 1-2.
354,700.
They're talking about a lot of money in the background. The paid attendance, 47,797. So they're talking about money over $350,000. Fastball hit up the middle. Versailles near the bag to nail him. Willie Davis, went out deep to Tony Oliva in the first inning. The left fielder making a fine leaping catch, and last time up, struck out.
The Dodgers.
Willie likes to get his swings. He's a first ball hitter if it's around the plate. He is one of the tougher men in the Dodger lineup to walk.
And Twins actually club share $30,156.72 to each club. The American League and National League shares amounted to $30,156.73.
$7-1 in favor of Minnesota. We're in the sixth inning in Jim Mudcat Grant.
Federal taxes, $30,657.
Hit into left field and sinking for a base hit.
$657 federal taxes.
So Willie Davis gets the Dodgers' fifth hit.
Ron Fairley.
And with one out, Ron Fairley, the batter. Fairley homered in the second inning, flied to right in the fourth. And it was a difference of inches. He hit a high fastball for the home run and the pitch a fastball a little lower, and he flied to right. Ron has had hand trouble since early August. Fly ball to left field. Valdespino going back a bit as the wind takes it. He's there. Sulley. Willie, of course, with the Dodgers trailing 7-1, figures to be a quiet base runner. Peter Lawford, Bethel Leslie, and special guest Roderick Crawford star in March from Camp Tyler when Bob Hope presents the Chrysler Theater tonight at 9, 8 Central Time in color here on NBC. Lou Johnson 0 for 2. Make it 1 for 3. Willie goes to second and holds there. The Dodgers have to go 90 feet at a time, trailing by 6. So 2 on, 2 out, and Jim LaFever the batter.
Number 5, Jim LaFever.
LaFever flied to left and grounded out to second base, 0 for 2. Fastball hit right at the shortstop side. No runs, two hits, two left. And the score at the end of 5.5 innings of play. Minnesota 7, the Dodgers 1.
When you see an automobile as proudly beautiful as this Chrysler, you expect it to take special care of you, and it does. The driver's seat adjusts 6 ways. Up, down, forward, and back. The wheel adjusts up or down, in or out, so you can always drive easy and relaxed. Even your passenger never had it so good. And when the sun goes down into dusk, Chrysler's head and rear lights go on automatically. Now you're home. You switch off the motor, but not the lights. They stay on to light your way to the front door, and only then go off automatically. Yes, Chrysler does take special care of you. Move up to all the luxury of the Chrysler way of life.
I asked first-year player Frank Quillacy earlier today, just what have you been thinking about on the eve of your first World Series game?
I've just been thinking so darn much about the tickets and reservations that I've had to make since the in-laws and the folks got down that I haven't really had much chance to think about the ball game. Drysdale gone today. I think it's better if you don't think about it. Just go up there and look for a baseball and try and hit the darn thing.
Well, that's just what he did when he led off the third inning and pulled one inside third for a double, and that was the beginning of the end for Drysdale. And the beginning of a 6-run inning for the Twins. Quillacy also singled. He went 2 for 2 in the third inning. Fouled a curveball down on his ankle. So Quillacy will have to walk it off. One of the tip-offs, I think, on Drysdale's trouble was the fact that Quillacy, who figured to see a lot of curveballs and does not figure to pull too much, was able to pull a Drysdale fastball inside third. Minnesota trainer coming up to have a look at him. That's George Lenz making sure that Frank is all right. One and one to Frank Quillacy. We're in the bottom of the sixth inning, 7-1 Minnesota. Jim Brewer, the third Dodger pitcher. Fastball fouled away. Curve missed. 2-2. In the Dodger bullpen, they're sharpening up somebody on whom they figure to rely on during the series, although not necessarily today, to get him a little work. Two and two. Fastball hit in the air to left field. Johnson is there. One away.
Number 33, Jeff Grant.
Here's Ron Karnofsky loosening up in the Dodger bullpen. The Dodger bullpen did not see too much work during the close of the season. In winning 15 out of 16, the Dodger staff had 8 shutouts. Here's Jim Grant, and he got a well-deserved round of applause. Ball one. Ray, have you seen Jim look much better than he has today?
Oh, perhaps in certain respects, but I honestly think Jim is very much like a pitcher who pitches just as well as he thinks he has to pitch to win. In other words, with a lead, he concentrates on throwing strikes. That's his basic philosophy.
And so far, since the Twins got out in front, he's allowed 5 hits, but they came with 2 outs and no runs. 1-2. The Dodgers had 1 hit in the top of the 4th, then 2 singles in the 5th, 2 singles in the 6th, but no runs. They have only the run by Fairley's home run in the 2nd. 1-2. Hit inside third and down the line. He hung a curveball, and Lou Johnson, chasing it in the corner, slips and falls down, but recovers, and Grant has himself a stand-up double. Second hit off Brewer, the 9th hit for the Twins. The Twins with 9 hits have 2 home runs and 3 doubles. We'll calmly accept this one. Here is Zoilo Versailles. Struck out twice, but in between did a 3-run home run in the 3rd. This figures to be Brewer's last inning of work. He's due to bat 3rd when the Dodgers hit in the 7th. 1 out, Grant at 2nd base, 7-1 Minnesota. Versailles is a first ball hitter. At least he has the reputation. Strike 2. Jim Brewer, many years ago, about 9 to be exact, was seriously injured in a fight with a ball player who is now coaching at third base for the Minnesota Twins, Billy Martin. Line drive into center, base hit. Grant to 3rd, and they're waving him in. And the throw will go into 2nd base. 8-1, Minnesota. And Zoilo Versailles stands at first base with 5 runs batted in. He's got reason to smile. Sandy is 1-for-3. Leading 8-1, and he works a piece of gum to death. Whoa. Brewer, figuring the Twins now might want to practice a little hit and run. The crowd wants Versailles to steal. 8-1 Minnesota, bottom of the 6th, and the crowd chanting, go. Almost had him leaning the wrong way, but the throw came on the wrong side of the bag. Brewer has, an average move to first. There he goes, the pitch out. Roseboro, high to the receiver. He's in there. Let's take a look at that again. NBC instant replay. There he goes. The throw is high, and he's under the tag. On a pitch out, one ball and no strikes to Valdespino. In there, one and one. 8 runs, 10 hits, and no errors. 1 run, 6 hits, and 1 error for the Dodgers. Ball two. Still worried about Versailles out there at second base. Ground ball pulled to Parker. He goes to the bag. Versailles goes to third. That brings up Tony Oliva with Versailles at third and two out, a run over in the sixth, and the Twins leading 8-1. Oliva grounded to short, grounded to third, flied to center, made a fine defensive play in the first inning on a drive by Willie Davis. To Oliva. Oliva is not a wrist hitter. He's more of a sweep type, so that he hits a lot to the opposite field. Grounded foul outside of third, and a pretty good example of it. You have a hitter who swings such as Tony Oliva, you try to jam him. 0-2. Duello Versailles at third base. Chased the curve, fouled it away, lost his bat. As Ray mentioned earlier, Tony has had a hand trouble and consequently still has a problem holding on to that bat. One Minnesota, two out, bottom of the sixth. Zoilo Versalles at third base. Dodgers have used Drysdale, Reed, and Brewer. 7 of the 8 runs charged to Drysdale. Low and away. 1-2. Into left field, and fading on it is Johnson. That'll do it. So they get a run on 2 hits and leave a man. And at the end of the sixth inning, the score, Minnesota 8, the Dodgers 1. We pause now for station identification.
This is the CBC Television Network.
Commissioner Ford Frank, enjoying the 62nd World Series. In the previous 61, the American League won 37 and the National League 24. Friends, throughout the football season, NBC will bring you the top college football games of the year, highlighted by such classics as USC-Notre Dame, Texas-Arkansas, Nebraska-Oklahoma, and Army-Navy. And then at the end of the year, NBC brings you the most and the best of the postseason bowl games, featuring the East-West Shrine Game and the Senior Bowl, and topped by that New Year's Day triple header, the Sugar Bowl, the Rose Bowl, and the Orange Bowl, all in color and exclusively on NBC. Ball one to Wes Parker. Wes likes to bunt. 1-0 the count. He is struck out and flied to left, 0-2. 1-1 the count. Wes Parker, Johnny Roseboro, and we'll see about a hitter for Brewer in the seventh. Ball two. Grant with a good fastball and moving the pitches in and out. Away. Ball three. Grant has not walked a batter. He has struck out four. In there at the knees. 3-2. 8-1 Minnesota, seventh inning. High and away. Ball four, and there's number one, issued by Grant.
Number eight, Scott Roseboro.
Parker at first base. And Johnny Roseboro checks in, fouled out to third, and single to right. Lasias to the mound to talk to Grant. Roseboro, basically a low ball hitter. He's had trouble pulling. As John said, his bat has gotten lazy. Strike. Dodgers have Wally Moon out on deck to bat for Jim Brewer. Missed. One ball, one strike. Parker at first. They're not going to hold him. Leading 8-1 in the seventh. Curveball over. Good one. When Grant changes up, he changes off the curveball, but we haven't seen him throw one change off the fastball yet. Fastball fouled away. High fly ball to right field. Oliva back and over to his right. One away. The Dodger bullpen, Ron Karanowski, has stopped.
Ladies and gentlemen, for the Los Angeles Dodgers,
right-hander Bob Miller and left-hander Johnny Padres are up. And here's the announcement on Wally Moon. Miller the right-hander, Padres the left-hander, of course. And the Twins have a left-hander, Jim Merritt, loosening up in their bullpen. Ball one to Wally. There's Jim Merritt, who worked in the Dodger clubhouse in 1961 with another kid by the name of Jim LeFevre. They both played on the Dodger rookie club in 61, and now they're in the big one. Pop fly, back to third, Killebrew and Versailles, and Killebrew. Two outs.
Number 30, Maury Wills.
Wills struck out, fouled out, and with two on and two out on the fifth, hit a line drive into left center, and Jimmy Hall made a fine running catch. So Maury is 0 for 3. On the hand, ball one. Before the game, Jim Grand said that the way he was going to prevent Wills from stealing all those bases was to keep him off the bases, and he's done it. So far, base hit to right. Parker goes the 90 feet. The run is at first and second with two out, and Jim Gilliam the batter.
Jim Merritt, the left-hander warming up for the Twins.
Number 19.
Seven hits off Grand.
Jim Gilliam.
And the batter is Jim Gilliam. Jim is in his sixth World Series. 1953, his first one. Today, he's 1 for 3. Wills at first will be quiet now, but when he talks about base running, here's what he has to say.
I feel that a base runner or a base stealer such as myself has to run constantly, just as a pitcher has to pitch every 4 days in order to maintain his rhythm and timing, and a hitter having to play every game in order to keep his rhythm and timing at the plate. I have to, as a base runner, a base stealer, run often in order to keep my timing on the bases, my rhythm as far as getting the jump and being quick, deciding when the pitcher is going to pick me off and when he's going home. So because of this reason, a lot of times I steal a base when maybe we're 4 or 5 runs ahead in the latter part of the game, and sometimes maybe 2, 3, or 4 runs behind early in the ball game. Sometimes I'm criticized for this, but that's only because people don't realize why I'm running or my reason for running.
So says the captain. 2-2 to Gilliam with two out in the seventh, 8-1 Minnesota. Parker at second, Wills at first. Willie Davis on deck. High fly ball to right field. Oliva's there. That'll do it. No runs, a hit, two men left, and the score at the end of 6.5 innings of play. Minnesota 8, the Dodgers 1.
The new Dodge and Fargo trucks work harder and longer for you. And now, another message from Chrysler. September 26, 1962, Chrysler Canada Limited announced the 5-year or 50,000-mile powertrain warranty. These cars carried it, the 1963 Chrysler-built cars. Today, many of these cars have new car warranty left. Think of this when you're buying a new 1966 car. Think of still having warranty protection in 1968, 69, or even 70. Makes sense to buy a car or truck from Chrysler.
Big crowd of 47,797, a new Metropolitan Stadium record. And coming in out of the Dodger bullpen is Ron Peranoski.
Ron Peranoski.
This might come as some surprise to people to say, how in the world would you bring in your ace when you are trailing 8-1? However, the Dodgers' starters were so strong and so effective in the last 2 weeks of the pennant race that the bullpen suffered from inactivity. And Peranoski thrives on work. And so Walter Alston decided to better get him in a little work here. So he is the fourth Dodger pitcher. Drysdale, Reed, and Brewer have preceded him. Peranoski was in 59 games during the year, an ERA of 2, won and lost record of 6-6, and has been almost overpowering since
early. Number 3, Harmon Killebrew.
This 1965 World Series game is being brought to you live and in color, exclusively on NBC. Harmon has struck out twice and singled. Peranoski throws curveballs and sinkers. Curveball, ball one. In the language of pitchers, Paranoski drags his arm. He gives you a lot of body motion, and then the arm comes around. Sinker for strikes. One and one. Eight to one, Minnesota, bottom of the seventh inning. In the dirt, ball two. Johnny Roseboro says that he can catch Drysdale and Koufax without feeling half the shock and the pain of catching a Paranoski sinker. Curve in the dirt, ball three. We hadn't worked in about 9 days, and he can use it. Three and one. Three and one to Harmon Killebrew.
47 and two-thirds innings. Just two earned runs.
Fouled away. The Minnesota bullpen also wants to get their relief men sharp. And so the number one right-hander, Alan Worthington, loosening up. There's Big Red. Three and two. Slow curve high. So Killebrew walks to open the seventh. And that'll bring up Jimmy Hall.
Number seven, Jimmy Hall.
Jimmy Hall struck out twice, singled off Lefevre's glove, and made a fine defensive play. On deck, Don Mincher. Paul checking to see if perhaps the bunt is on. Checking Billy Martin. Jimmy drags well. Rolls one up along first. Parker letting it roll. Foul. So Hall will try it again, and Killebrew back to first. One ball and one strike to Jim. Eight runs, 10 hits for the Twins. One run, 7 hits, and an error for the Dodgers. Bottom of the seventh. Curve is in there. One and two. Gilliam is back in a normal depth of third now that they have two strikes on Hall. Each side scored a run in the first, in the second inning, and then the Twins tore it apart with six in the third. Sinker missed. Minnesota added another in the sixth inning, and they lead 8-1. Low curve, fouled away. Harmon Killebrew at first. Nobody out. Breeze is picked up again, blowing from right to left. Sinker missed. 3-2. Now we'll see if the Twins play run and hit with a full count. Run and hit, of course, with a three-ball count on the batter. He's not obligated to chase ball four. Different from hit and run. Did not go, and the runner, ball four. So the Twins with runners at first and second, and a Rusty Paranoski has walked two, and
number
now faces Don Mincher.
Don Mincher.
Mincher homered in the second inning, walked and scored a run in the third, hit into a force play in the fifth. So Don is one for two. The Dodgers think that Mincher will bunt. Both Parker and Gilliam are up. He's around to bunt. Takes a curve for a strike. A throw down to Wills. Not in time. Killebrew back. Killebrew at second. Hall at first. And Mincher checking again with Billy Martin. Missed. 1-1. Mincher checking Billy Martin. He fouled it away, trying to bunt. 1-2. Seventh inning, 8-1, Minnesota. Armin Killebrew at second, Jimmy Hall at first, nobody out. 1-2, the count to Don Mincher with Earl Batty on deck. Curveball, hit into right center, fairly on the move. One hands it on the dead run, and the runners have to scamper back. Nice play by Ron Fairley. The only thing that made that play possible was Fairley had a good jump.
Number 10, Earl Batty.
Earl Batty flied to left, looped a single to right, and grounded out. 1-3. He's another fellow with a rep of being a first ball hitter, and the Twins like to play hit and run with him. Fouled it back. 0-1. Armin Killebrew at second, Jimmy Hall at first, one out. 8-1 Minnesota, bottom of the seventh. Ron Paranoski, the fourth Dodger pitcher. Sinker missed, 1-1. Friends, Dean Martin welcomes this All-Star cast tomorrow night at 10, 9 Central Time. Vic Damone, Alan Sherman, Gordon and Sheila McRae, Johnny Wallace, and Ferranti and Teicher. The Dean Martin Show tomorrow night in color on NBC. One and one. Sinker hit back to Paranoski. He goes high to Wills. He got him and goes to first on a bounce for a weird double play. 1-6-3. No runs, no hits, a man left. And at the end of seven, the score, Minnesota 8 and the Dodgers 1. The Dodgers are not going to show that last double play in spring training to the rookies, but we'll show you how to do it the hard way.
He goes high to Wills.
Kicks the bag on a bounce to Parker for the double play. Beautiful. Here's Willie Davis. Then Ron Fairley and Lou Johnson. 8-1 Minnesota in the eighth. Killebrew on the grass. Line to right. Oliva puts it away. One out. Ron Fairley did a home run in the second inning, flied to right and flied to left, and made the nice running catch on the drive by Mincher.
Number 6, Ron Fairley.
One. High drive into right center. Oliva going back on the ball, away back to the wire, and makes the catch. So Fairley goes out about 375.
Number 41, Lou Johnson.
Let's look at that again and watch how the wind pulls it away.
High drive into right.
Looks like he's there, and then quickly over. Lou Johnson, ball one. Lou has struck out, popped up, and single to left, one for three. Fisted on a little looper to second base. He was jammed, and they're out in order. And a score at the end of 7.5 innings of play, Minnesota 8, the Dodgers 1.
Swinging people, swinging car.
Swinging coronet.
Along comes this exciting new car by Dodge.
Swinging coronet.
And suddenly all the other cars in its class are really not quite with it.
Swinging coronet.
Coronet by Dodge makes them all look so, so, so.
It's got the most in its class. It's by itself in its class.
Here is a car.
Swinging coronet.
Your Dodge dealer sells it. Get with it.
Swinging coronet. Great new car just for you. Get into the swing. Swinging coronet by Dodge.
Swinging coronet?
Bottom of the eighth inning, 8-1 Minnesota. Frank Quillacy, pitcher Jim Grant, and Zoilo Vasayas coming up in that order.
Number 11, Frank Quillacy.
Quillacy double, singled, and flied to left. His double was the opening shot in the third round when Minnesota scored six times and broke the game wide open. Chased the sinker. Drive into left field. Johnson over to his left. Makes the catch. One away.
Number 33, Jeff Grant.
An ovation building up, and well-deserved for Jim Grant. So watch Johnson make that running catch. Jim has one hit today, a double. He also sacrificed in the third inning, trying to bunt Quillacy over to third. Drysdale fell down and then threw on a bounce to Lefevre, who juggled. Everybody was safe, and then it started. Fly ball down the line, slicing away from Fairley, but he's there. Fair ball if you're scoring. Two out. Zoilo Vasayas had the big home run in the third inning with Quillacy and Grant aboard. Singled in the sixth, stole a base. He's 2-for-4. Ray, it seems quite a surprise to see a fellow like Vasayas and realize how he led the league in total bases and all his power. He's deceptive.
He's very strong. And, of course, in the leadoff spot to knock in 77 runs, those with the Twins felt that was an outstanding achievement as well. He has deceptive power.
In the leadoff spot, he drove in 77. The Dodgers' top man was Fairley. He drove in 70 in the cleanup role.
Tony Oliva.
Curveball hit foul.
Has tied the World Series record for most putouts in a nine-inning game by a right fielder. The record was originally set by John Murray of the New York Giants in 1912, and tied by Ed Miller of
1-2.
A's in 1930 by Ray Blades, the St. Louis Cardinals in 1930. Playing against each other on the same day, October 5th, Miller and Blades each had 7 putouts for the respective
1-2.
Right field.
All two. If you're not keeping score, when the Dodgers come up in the ninth inning, they are due to send up Jim Lefevre, Wes Parker, and Johnny Roseboro. Ball three. Aronofsky pitching his second inning in relief. Fouled away. Minnesota 8, Los Angeles 1 here in the bottom of the 8th. Big hopper to third, foul. Well, they'll try it again.
Another record was tied today. Occurred back in the second inning when Don Mincher hit a home run. He became the fourth player in World Series history to hit a home run on his first World Series at bat. The others who did it were Dusty Rhodes of the New York Giants in 1954.
3-2.
Elton Howard, New York Yankees in 1955. Roger Maris.
Sinker hit the Gilliam, foul again. Almost a duplicate of the last ground ball.
Fourth, to hit a home run on his first World Series at bat.
Sinker fouled off to the right, out of play. Tomorrow afternoon, it'll be left-hander Jim Cott for the Minnesota Twins and left-hander Sandy Koufax for the Dodgers. This Sunday, NBC will telecast one of the top American Football League games of the year when the San Diego Chargers meet the Buffalo Bills at Buffalo. This Sunday, the Buffalo Bills, the San Diego Chargers. Line drive at Wills. That'll do it. They're out in order in the eighth. And so at the end of the eighth inning, the score, Minnesota 8, the Dodgers 1.
Have a ball in a Valiant sedan. Get out, have fun in a Valiant sedan. There's room for everyone and more in a Valiant sedan.
Raise the roof in a Valiant convertible. Get out and go in a Valiant convertible. Feel the fresh breeze blow in a Valiant convertible.
Live it up in a Valiant hardtop. Get out and swing in a Valiant hardtop. Now's the time for a fling in a Valiant hardtop.
And remember, nobody beats Valiant for value.
Ninth inning, 8-1 Minnesota, the Dodgers with Jimmy Lefevre, Wes Parker, and Johnny Roseboro. Lefevre flied to left, grounded to second, lined out to short, 0-3. Line base hit to left field. Eight hits for the Dodgers. But the only run came on a leadoff home run by Ron Fairley in the second inning.
Number 28, Wes Parker.
Wes Parker struck out, flied to left and walked.
Tied today was the feat of the Twins' Frank Quillacy in getting two base hits in the second inning today.
High foul, slicing off third and out of play.
On 12 occasions, the last man to do it was Bob Serve of the New York Yankees on October 8th, 1960, in the first inning. Two hits in an inning for Pulisic ties a record held by 12 players previously.
Breaking ball over. Good curve. 0-2. Ground ball up the middle. Base hit. Lefevre goes to second and decides to keep going. He's the first Dodger in the last four innings to take an extra base. The run is at first and third, nobody out, and Johnny Roseboro the batter. Parker hit an 0-2 curveball up the middle. Johnny Roseboro has fouled out, singled, and flied out for the Dodgers with nine hits. Everyone in the starting lineup has one of them, except the pitcher, but his pinch hitter picked up one, Willie Crawford. Fastball, pop foul off third. Killebrew coming over to the boxes. He's got it. One out. Coming out of the Dodger dugout, Don LeJohn. He wears his age on his uniform. He's 31 years old. In the Dodger organization for 10 and a half years. And at Albuquerque was a player coach. And was eventually called up and did a fine job. So Don LeJohn, after waiting 10 and a half years in the minors, gets into a World Series. Two on, one out. 8-1 Minnesota in the ninth. Grant trying to lock it up. The Dodgers have used both left-hand pinch hitters, Wally Moon and Willie Crawford. So now they have to dip into the right-handers. Fastball for strike. Grant now has been hit on the curve in this inning. He'll probably go back to that fastball. Boom, he really ripped another one. I say he's going to the fastball, 0-2. So Jim Grant, who has four strikeouts and stopped striking out people back in the fourth inning, now trying to close up shop, 0-2. Breaking ball, got him swinging. So two fastballs and a curve disposes of LeJohn. Two out and the Mudcat is one out away.
Moy Wills
struck out, fouled out, lined out to Hall in left center and single to right, 1-for-4. The bunt, foul. Wes Parker back to first. Jimmy Lefevre holding a third. Will's trying to pick somebody up. Fastball butted up along first. Mudcat picks it up, throws on a bounce, too late. The bases have first and second, and the run is over. The Wills outlegs that bunt up along first base. And it makes it 8-2.
Base hit.
A bunt single for Wills. Parker to second, Lefevre scores. So the Dodgers now with two runs on 10 hits. The Twins have eight runs on 10 hits. Fastball is hit into left center. Valdespino racing over and makes the catch for the out. In the ninth inning for the Dodgers, they get one run on three hits and lead two. And the final score at Metropolitan Stadium, the Minnesota Twins 8 and the Dodgers 2. For Minnesota, 8 runs, 10 hits, and no errors. For the Dodgers, 2 runs, 10 hits, and 1 error. In a moment, we'll review the highlights of the game for you.
Plymouth Belvedere. There's something about a brand new, sparkling Plymouth Belvedere that sets a man a-dreaming. Fireball O'Hare, champion of the world's most grueling cross-country rallies, yet again sets out to smash records all across the country in his hot new Plymouth Belvedere. No test is too hazardous as Fireball meets every challenge. And who is once again the unbeatable champion? The unconquerable O'Hare and his hot new Belvedere Satellite. Yes, Plymouth Belvedere sets a man a-dreaming. But man, what dreams. And it's the kind of car that fits a young family's budget.
Remember, folks, for 66, there are two great Plymouths, the hot new Belvedere and the big new Fury.
Both cars are backed by Plymouth's famous warranty. Belvedere, Fury.
They're the greatest.
47,797 Minnesotans filing out of Metropolitan Stadium as the Minnesota Twins win their first game of the 1965 World Series 8-2. To give you the official stats and the highlights of the ball game and close-up shot for the day, let's hop back over to Ray Scott.
Thank you, Vin Scully. The line score for the Twins winning this first game of the 1965 World Series. For Minnesota, 8 runs, 10 hits, no errors, and 5 men left on base. For the Los Angeles Dodgers, 2 runs, 10 hits, 1 error, and 9 men left on base. Jim Mudcat Grant, a 21-game winner in the regular season, goes the distance to notch the World Series opening win for the Twins. For the Dodgers, Don Drysdale took the loss as he worked 2 2/3 innings. And although he gave up 7 runs, only 3 were earned. Drysdale was followed by Howie Reed. Reed working 1 1/3 innings and allowing no runs or hits. Jim Brewer went 2 innings, allowed 3 hits and 1 run. And Ron Peronoski worked the final 2 innings, giving up no hits or runs. And as Vin Scully mentioned, although the Twins were leading 8-1, and the question might naturally rise as to why Peronoski was used in that situation, he needed the work. There were home runs for the Dodgers by Ron Fairley, for the Twins by Zoilo Versailles, his with 2 on, Fairley's was with the bases empty, and Don Mincher homered with none on for the Twins as well. Versailles knocked in a total of 4 runs for the Twins. This game is authorized under television rights granted by the Commissioner of Baseball solely for the entertainment of our audience. And any publication, reproduction, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of the commissioner is prohibited. Any commercial or other use of the program, such as by charging admission for its showing, is similarly prohibited unless authorized in writing by the commissioner. The weatherman has promised ideal weather again for tomorrow's game, which means that the sun should be shining here in Bloomington, Minnesota at Metropolitan Stadium, and the temperature should be around 70 degrees. Tune in tomorrow at 2:45 Eastern Daylight Time for the second game of this 1965 World Series, when your hosts, as today again, will be Chrysler Corporation, famous for quality engineering. Today's host, Plymouth, and Gillette, the people who know men best.
Peter Lawford, Bethel Leslie, and special guest Broderick Crawford star in March from Camp Tyler when Bob Hope presents the Chrysler Theater tonight at 9, 8 Central Time, in color here on NBC.
This is the CBC Television Network.